Hey, Vicki, how are you?
There's Mr. Whitman.
Ms. Bodalia, how are you?
Yeah, he's one of the regulars, too.
I'm going to call to order the House Armed Services Subcommittee on Readiness. I want to welcome all of our members and welcome back our distinguished panel to today's hearing focused on resetting the force for the future and to look at the risks of sequestration as it relates to that reset. This afternoon, we're privileged to have with us Lieutenant General Raymond V. Mason, Deputy Chief of Staff of the Army for Logistics, and Lieutenant General William M. Faulkner, Deputy Commandant of Installations and Logistics. Gentlemen, thank you so much for your service to our nation. Thank you for all of your efforts and leadership during these challenging times. And I thank you for being here with us this morning as we look at, or this afternoon, I should say, as we look at all this time runs together, as we look at the challenges that we have here before us. As we know, gentlemen, no one will dispute that we have the most capable and professional military in the world, and our men and women in uniform have exemplified the best America has to offer during the last 13 years of protracted counterinsurgency operations in the Middle East. Thanks to their tireless efforts, we're able to begin shifting our focus from combat operations towards resetting the force for the future. However, the challenges will not end as combat operations wind down in Afghanistan. 13 years of combat have taken their toll on every aspect of our military. Today's hearing focuses on the materiel impacts as the Army and Marine Corps face a staggering $11.2 million of reductions. We are concerned that this bill, this $11.2 million bill to restore readiness to vital military hardware, is going to create a challenge. And I believe this massive effort to retrograde, repair, replace, and upgrade equipment to a level of combat capability commensurate with the unit's future missions is vital to our operational readiness. Unfortunately, like everywhere else within the Department of Defense, sequestration has left its mark on these efforts as well. Facing smaller and smaller budgets for the replacement of war-torn equipment, critical reset work has been deferred, and the focus has shifted more to repair than procuring newer, more capable systems. I'm particularly concerned about how limited reset funding will impact our reserve component, who has and will continue to remain critical as a part of our total force structure. However, I fear that this desperately needed repair effort may also be in jeopardy if we continue much further down the road with sequestration. During my trip to Afghanistan earlier this year, I witnessed thousands of containers, hundreds of vehicles, and millions of individual items awaiting shipment home to units that desperately need them. All of these items are at risk as transportation costs continue to rise and budgets continue to shrink. At the same time the Marine Corps and the Army are working through these fiscal challenges, sequestration has caused additional uncertainty by forcing the Army to shed 72,000 soldiers and the Marine Corps 20,000 Marines to make ends meet, and an unknown number more the longer sequestration persists. Undoubtedly, this lack of certainty on the size and composition of the future force raises questions about what capabilities will be deemed enduring, what equipment should be reset to support those enduring requirements, and what resources Congress should provide to meet these requirements. Make no mistake about it, failure to properly and fully reset the force will invariably lead to placing more and more of our service members at risk in future conflicts. I've said it before and I'll say it again, increased risk means more men and women will die defending this nation when we ask them to do so. This afternoon, I look forward to hearing how the Marine Corps and the Army plan to reset the force in this challenging environment and how we are managing the uncertainty and risks we are facing in this critical area of readiness. We must not let our legacy be one of overseeing the slow dismantlement of the greatest military the world has ever known. We all have a responsibility to ensure our men and women in uniform are given all the tools necessary for the job we have asked them to do. And I look forward to hearing from our witnesses And I would now like to turn to my dear friend and ranking member, Madeline Bordaglio, for any remarks that she may have.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for holding this hearing in spite of the uncertainty that we're experiencing today on the Hill. I welcome back to both General Mason and General Faulkner, and I know you are both familiar with our subcommittee, and I thank you for your visits to my office, and it's good to see you again. I appreciate your testimony today and your leadership during these challenging times. I appreciate hearing your comments on reset and retrograde during a time of fiscal uncertainty. The only thing that is clear in the budget picture is that sequestration is detrimental to our military readiness and is completely unnecessary. Unfortunately, we meet today during a government shutdown that was completely avoidable. While the Affordable Care Act has dominated the discussion as the shutdown occurred, the underlying issue is really our budget situation in the impact of sequestration. Congress has the ability, but not the desire, to fix sequestration. And I continue to urge leadership to seek a comprehensive solution that ends sequestration once and for all. And I hope that we will come to a compromise in the near term as we discuss how to solve these budget issues. It is indeed unfortunate that Congress has placed the Department of Defense in the position that you are in today. I fully support having a robust military to defend our great nation and our interests, but it is the responsibility of Congress to ensure the Defense Department has the necessary resources to succeed when confronted with current and emerging threats. I support ending sequestration immediately and in its entirety, not just piecemeal. Finding a comprehensive solution to sequestration will allow the Department of Defense and other federal agencies to properly plan and prepare for potential conflicts of the future. Clearly, Congress is not allowing the world's greatest fighting force to effectively and efficiently maintain peace. We in Congress are the problem, sorry to say. And I ask that all of my colleagues put aside all of the political positioning and understand what is at stake here. The time for action is now. The discussion today regarding resetting our force, given the real and immediate implications of sequestration, is of high interest to this subcommittee. Thousands of U.S. assets have been heavily used, often well beyond their service life, throughout the harsh environment in the Middle East in support of operations in Iraq and Afghanistan. It is important for our subcommittee members to understand the challenges with returning equipment from Afghanistan to units at home and inducted into military depots. I'm interested to hear your views today on how the Army and the Marine Corps prioritize equipment reset among many competing interests and units, from home station units to foreign military sales. How are the assets that were primarily designed to use in Iraq and Afghanistan prioritized during reset, knowing our next conflict may not be fought in the same type of environment? What is the underlying strategy? Moreover, I hope our witnesses will address what impact that sequestration will have on your current plans to reset and retrograde. I'm particularly concerned that if we do not find a comprehensive solution to sequestration, that it could create complications for retrograde of materials out of Afghanistan and also set back goals for reset of equipment. Ultimately, I do not want to see a situation where any units stateside or in the territories, particularly our National Guard, are not equipped and ready to respond to any natural disaster or some other type of contingency. This would simply be unacceptable given that we can solve sequestration right here in Congress. I also hope to hear about the Marine Corps process for reset and how you are addressing readiness issues with the 3rd Marine Expeditionary Force. As we pivot to the Asia-Pacific region, it is more important than ever that we make the 3rd Marine Expeditionary Force whole again and ensure they have the proper equipment to meet current and emerging requirements in this theater over the coming years. In terms of whether to repair, rebuild, or replace, how do you assess what equipment now being used in Afghanistan is appropriate for the challenges that exist in the Asia-Pacific region. So again, thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I do look forward to our witnesses' testimony and our question and answer period. Thank you.
Madeline, thank you very much, and we will now go to our witnesses. And Lieutenant General Mason, we will begin with you.
Well, good afternoon, Chairman Whitman, Ranking Member Bordaio, and distinguished members of the subcommittee. Thank you for the opportunity to testify today. I submitted a longer statement for the record, but I'd like to touch on a few subjects that are critical to Army retrograde and reset, which both of you spoke of in your opening remarks. After more than a decade of conflict in Iraq and Afghanistan, the nation and our Army are certainly in a period of transition. The Army is bringing back soldiers and equipment while finishing operations and training Afghan forces. Our goal is to retrograde all non-enduring equipment out of Afghanistan by October 2014. To meet future requirements and improve readiness, the Army plans to retrograde approximately $17 billion worth of equipment that is still in Afghanistan. However, the 2014 retrograde timeline assumes generally stable conditions. For example, surface lines of communication, such as the Pakistan ground line of communication, which we call the PAK-GLOC, and to a lesser extent, the Northern Distribution Network, the NDN, are critical to meeting our timelines, and they are less expensive than the multimodal and direct air transportation. Unfortunately, the PAK-GLOC and the NDN are not always viable and open. Additionally, other variables, including increased enemy activity, potential delays in Afghan elections, would most certainly affect our retrograde and drawdown plans. Once the equipment is retrograded, it must be reset to a required level to support units, missions, and the national military strategy. Thanks to the support of Congress and our American citizens, the Army to date has invested $55 billion in operations and maintenance funds and $35 billion in procurement funds to recover from both Iraq and Afghanistan to date. That investment has enabled the Army to maintain operational readiness rates at equipment at about 90% for ground and about 75% in aviation. That's for the forces in theater, not back at home. They are much lower than that. To reset the necessary equipment, OCO funding must continue for 3 years after the last piece of equipment comes back from Afghanistan. In FY13, the Army expected to reset approximately 100,000 items in its organic industrial facilities, and more than 600,000 pieces of equipment on site where units are stationed. However, FY13 sequestration impacts caused a $1.7 billion cut to reset, and we had to defer nearly $800 million of reset to future years, all immediately impacting equipment readiness today. In fact, as the Chief of Staff of the Army testified 2 weeks ago, the Army only has one brigade combat team that is at C1. Full and predictable funding is critical to the health of our organic industrial base and Army readiness. We must ensure the organic industrial base remains effective, efficient, and capable of meeting Army contingency requirements. To help address these issues, we published our first Army Organic Industrial Base Strategic Plan. This plan details the strategy and management framework needed to ensure that our depots and arsenals remain viable, effective, and efficient. The current fiscal uncertainty could drastically impact that strategy. In conclusion, to protect our nation's Army logistics capabilities and ensure that our Army's readiness is maintained, I encourage you to reverse sequestration and to ensure that the OCO accounts used for retrograde and reset are fully funded for 3 years after the last piece of equipment has left Afghanistan. I thank you again for your continued support of our soldiers and their families, and I look forward to your questions.
Thank you, Lieutenant General Mason. We'll now go to Lieutenant General Faulkner.
Chairman Whitman, Ranking Member Bordaio, members of the committee, thank you for this opportunity to update this committee on the Marine Corps' Afghanistan equipment retrograde and reset actions. Your Marines take seriously our sacred oath to defend our nation, our Constitution, and the American people. In Afghanistan today, Marines continue to support the transition of security and responsibility to the Afghan government and people. As my Commandant testified to this committee about 2 weeks ago, Marine Corps readiness is directly linked to resources and the enduring impacts of the Budget Control Act of 2011 to include sequestration will force us to forfeit our long-term priorities to fund near-term readiness. In my testimony today, I would like to underscore the importance of our ground equipment reset strategy and its linkage to enduring operational readiness. Completing the full reset of our equipment is in line with our fidelity to the taxpayer and the continued availability of overseas contingency operations, or OCO funds, is critical to completing our reset strategy. This strategy was built on the recognition of tightening budgets and the expeditious use of available OCO funds to achieve a properly equipped and ready force capable of conducting the full range of military operations. We are moving with a clear sense of purpose to rapidly restore equipment readiness in a fiscally conscientious manner, and we need to maintain the tempo that we currently have underway. In order to avoid enduring reductions to our overall operational readiness, we need continued OCO funding for 2 to 3 years after the last Marines leave Afghanistan. When I last appeared before this committee 6 months ago, the Marine Corps had recently completed its post-surge recovery. In the year between December 2011 and December 2012, the Marine Corps redeployed its 2009 surge forces and retrograded over 39,000 associated items of equipment. If you had a picture of our major forward operating base, Camp Bastion, at the height of our surge, and one of the same base today, in today's picture you would see empty lots that were once stacked with shipping containers and equipment. You'd see empty warehouses that were once filled with supplies and repair parts, and you'd see vacant aircraft parking ramps. To put the effort into context, since our first Marine Corps units redeployed at the end of 2011, 67% of the 72,000 equipment items have already been removed from our Marine Corps portion of the Joint Coalition Operating Area in Afghanistan. Additionally, of the over 42,000 total items retrograded to date, 60% of those are being inducted at our depot maintenance plants in Albany, Georgia and Barstow, California. In total, we've completed reset actions on about one-third of the items returned from Afghanistan. Not to say that there's not hard work ahead of us. Tomorrow's fiscal environment will certainly impact our ability to complete our reset strategy, and we still have much to do. In FY13, the Marine Corps was fully funded for reset to include an additional $120 million in depot maintenance graciously provided by the Congress in H.R. 933. However, required maintenance conducted at our depot production plants was deferred as a result of the 6-day furlough of our civilian Marine workforce. It's important to point out that even seemingly nominal cuts compound increasing workload requirements as maintenance is deferred to another year. This will have a detrimental effect on our readiness if funding limitations extend into FY14 and beyond. As I close, I want to point out that our readiness is preserved through a careful balance of high-quality people, well-trained units, modernized equipment, well-maintained installation, and a force level sufficient to accomplish our missions. The Marine Corps recognizes the realities of the fiscal constraints before us, and our responsibility to ensure our reset strategy places the right equipment in the right hands at the right cost of the warfighter. With the continued support of Congress, the Marine Corps will remain to meet the nation's next crisis in any climate or place. Thank you again for the opportunity to address this committee, and I look forward to your questions.
Very good. Thank you, Lieutenant General Faulkner. We appreciate it. And gentlemen, thanks again for your service to our nation and for joining us today and for giving us that general overview about what the impact of reset will be in the conditions placed on us by the sequester. I wanted to get you to go a little bit further, though, in characterizing for both of your service branches, what would the impact be based on sequestration, either curtailing or significantly delaying those efforts to reset? And then if you could tell us which areas would be most challenged, where do you see the biggest immediate impact and what would be the most difficult for you to overcome? And remember, that's also an element of time. So even if you were to get the resources, but they're spread out over a longer period of time, you know, what does that mean for your service branches? I just wanted to get a little more of a feeling, a characterization about how we could tell people this would affect the Army and the Marine Corps. General Mason.
Yes, Chairman Whitman, I think I'll start off with describing the workforce, because I think that's the place where we're taking an incredible amount of risk. We certainly are focused on plant equipment and modernization of our industrial base, but it's really the workforce. Based on sequestration in 13, we can attribute about 2,000 employees that were lost through sequestration. Another 2,000 came down because of workload reduction. But we didn't anticipate that sequestration, so that was a huge loss in workforce. Inside of that are very technical skills. For example, at Corpus Christi, our aviation depot, we lost 36 master engineers that went off to find jobs someplace else in the oil industry or wherever, because they saw this furlough in 13 and they looked out into 14 and 15 and perhaps they predicted what we're at, where we're at today, which is not a good thing. So I'm very concerned about the workforce and our industrial base and its ability to do that. Secondly is the equipment piece. So we had planned to, as I said, execute about $4 billion worth of reset. We lost about $1.7 billion in that. That equates to about 800 vehicles we weren't able to reset, 2,000 weapons, about 10,000 pieces of communication gear, 32 helicopters that we had to not do this year. All that got pushed into 14, and now we are in 14, not able to do that work again because of where we're at. So I think it's this combination of the people, which are the key thing, and it's difficult to grow those people and bring them back. And I would say, to conclude, we are eating our seed corn. We're eating our future. Those people that would want to join us, they would say, this is a great place to serve. I want to work at Anniston Army Depot. I want to work at Corpus Christi. They look at our situation. It's very unpredictable. So we've got this issue of predictability and balance, and we have neither of those right now, and that is dramatically impacting our workforce and our ability to get this equipment back into the hands of our soldiers for whatever's required of the next mission for this nation.
Very good. General Faulkner?
Yes, sir. Just some similarities, but let me give you some a little bit of different numbers. Primary impact, similar to the Army, was really to our depots and to our civilian workforce, specifically at Albany, Georgia and Barstow, California. And so just as a result of 6 days of furlough, which perhaps to the uninformed may seem relatively modest, 1,200 pieces of equipment we were not able to induct in our maintenance system. And that stuff, again, that's deferred out to the right, and that's you just can't catch up on it. And so those are items such as radars, communication equipment, vehicles that are already destined for our operating forces. One of the things that our commandant put in place early on is we published an Afghanistan equipment reset strategy and a playbook. So every one of these pieces of equipment that's in Afghanistan today, right at 24,000 of them, have a home, and they're part of our future. And the challenge with us now is that if they don't come home on time, as we planned, our focus being those forward deployed crisis response forces, they go without, or their readiness is not as high. And that's a challenge for us. The other piece, Chairman, to get to your second piece, are the longer-term impacts. The longer-term impacts, quite frankly, is just that deferred maintenance and that readiness is just going to be like a tsunami over time. It's just going to gain. One of our concerns, though, is that the conscious decision that our commandant has made is he is not going to take risk in forward-deployed crisis response forces. They're going to be ready. They're going to be ready to support a combat commander's requirements. Where he has taken risk in going in with full knowledge is on our bases and stations and our installations. And those are the areas that are going to really be most impacted over a longer period of time.
Mm-hmm. Very good. Thank you, Lieutenant General Faulkner. I'm going to go now to Ms. Bordalio.
Thank you again, Mr. Chairman. My first question is for you, General Mason. Can you further discuss for the subcommittee how the Army is working to ensure that National Guard units back in the United States and territories will receive equipment that is coming back from Afghanistan? That's the first part of the question. And further, can you elaborate on how the dual use and specific homeland defense mission equipment requirements will be met for National Guard units back in the states and the territories?
Yes, ma'am. I personally work with the Chief of the Army National Guard, Bill Ingram, and the Director of the Army Reserve, Jeff Talley, Lieutenant General Jeff Talley, and we look at the requirements they've got. I build that into our reset plan. So we have a total force policy, and the service, the individual compos, active, reserve, and National Guard, each get those equipment that's coming out of Afghanistan through our depots to those compos appropriately. In fact, right now the Army, total Army, is about at 88%. After we would complete all the retrograde out of Afghanistan, we would be at about 92% for equipment on hand, latest equipment that's being reset. That is across all three compos. We continue to focus on the modernization of the National Guard and the reserves as well, and that's a primary focus for the Secretary and the Chief of Staff. The dual purpose equipment is a key issue for me in the G4, and I'm watching that very closely as that equipment comes out. We make sure we get those things that the governors need to use for national emergencies or weather incidents in their states and territories. And so that is a high priority to make sure that that equipment also, and we've been pretty successful with that. I think the governors would tell you that. A vast majority of that equipment that was used in Iraq and Afghanistan, a lot of that has been returned. We still have more to come back to the dual use. So all of those are critical to, and we've got the guidance from the leadership of the Army to make sure that we have a total force policy.
Thank you. Thank you, General. Now, I realize that the retrograde of equipment from Afghanistan is going to be vastly different than the retrograde equipment from Iraq because of the transportation challenges. This is for both of you. And the lack of a holding area, such as we had for Iraq with Kuwait. Afghanistan is simply a more difficult logistics challenge. Could either of you expand on the issues surrounding the Northern Distribution Network and unforeseen logistics challenges? And then another part of the question is, we know that it is far more expensive to transport equipment through the NDN and that the Pakistan ground route is a fragile relationship. Additionally, fuel costs continue to consume DoD budgets, and we have a significant amount of equipment still in Afghanistan with some uncertainty about what must remain in the country in the absence of a bilateral security agreement. So how confident are you with the current retrograde plan to reduce the equipment in Afghanistan? Either one of you.
Yes, ma'am. I'll start and then Mark. Ma'am, I'm cautiously optimistic. Right now, we're on our glide slope that we had planned. But that can change overnight. One incident at a border, one thing that occurs could cause us challenges in there, so we watch it. What you just described is what I update I get every single morning on retrograde. So let me address a couple of your specific questions. So the Northern Distribution Network, I would describe that as a capillary as opposed to the Pakistan GLOC, which I would describe as an artery. We need them all. And one of our key solution sets in getting out of Afghanistan, same thing the Marines used as they begin to get out, is use all available transportation nodes, ground, air, sea, whatever we can work. So we're using all of those, multiple routes. So through the NDN, we're bringing mostly supplies in. There's not a lot going out through the NDN. One of the challenges with the NDN, it's very long, as you described, four times longer than the Pak-GLOC. More expensive in time and distance, obviously. Very many countries you've got to go through, so all those customs issues. And it's also north of a thing called the Salong Tunnel. The Salong Tunnel, through most of the winter months, is closed. Most of our forces are south of the Salong Tunnel. So we use it, but it is not our main route. We really want the Pak-GLOC to be our main route, and we're getting there. About 50% of what's departing Afghanistan right now is on the Pakistan GLOC. But a lot of it is flying out. It flies out in two ways. One, it flies out of Afghanistan to a local seaport in the Gulf region in the Middle East, and then we put it on ships because it's much cheaper to go on a ship than a plane. Some things do fly all the way back to the United States, critical items, weapons, things of that nature that we want to get right back, and that's called direct air. It's the most expensive, but we're using that very judiciously. The fuel issue is a concern, and that's why I have an estimate for retrograde, the rest of the Army equipment that's in Afghanistan, which the value of that right now today is about $17 billion. Our estimate is for the transportation cost is $2 to $3 billion. The reason I have such a big range in there, fuel is one of those variables. If fuel costs continue to go up, we're going to push into the $3 billion range. If the Pak-GLOC was to close, we could, in fact, go above that $3 billion range. And we'd have to fly more out. So that's why I have that variable in there. The BSA, as you described, the security agreement, basic security agreement, is key, and that allows us to work on that timeline that the President's established in December 2014. If things happen with that, and I guess I'd make this final point, the retrograde is driven by the political environment and the training of the Afghans and the drawdown of our forces and the closure of bases. And then retrograde follows that. So it's in response to whatever the commander on the ground says he's doing for base closures and as he works through the BSA.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Thank you, General. And General Faulkner.
Yes, ma'am. Thanks. Just a couple things to add to General Mason's comment. You did a great job of characterizing the fragile nature of both the Pak-GLOC and the NDN. The the success that we've had to date, the 67% reduction that I commented to in my opening statement, was really multimodal. So that was a period of time when the PAC-G lock was closed, and we flew that equipment out that General Mason described. And as you described, it is more expensive. But what I would say is that it's going to be more important over the course of the next six to nine months that, in fact, we maintain every opportunity to use all three of those methods of retrograding equipment, just because of the uncertainty associated with a couple of them. And that may be a cost that, as a nation, we just might have to endure to meet the timelines and based on our larger readiness. The other thing I will add, ma'am, is that we recognize our numbers pale in comparison to the Army's. Certainly, they're just as important to us, but just to give you a sense, our equipment cost in theater right now is $1.6 billion. And again, what I commented earlier, right now in theater, somewhere around 21,000 principal end items. And so of those, somewhere around 2,500 are rolling stock, and those are much smaller than our brothers and sisters in the Army. But the important last thing I will leave you with is going to be flexibility in getting multiple modes out, and General Dunford is working those in theater to deal with the uncertainty.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. I have just one final question. This is for both of you. Reset and retrograde have relied heavily on OGO funding. Now, as this funding dwindles and the department faces significant cuts as a result of the Budget Control Act and sequestration, how will the Army and the Marine Corps complete retrograde and reset?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. Let me go first. That oversees the contingency operations, or OCO funding that you refer to, is critical to us completing our reset. And if we don't continue to receive those OCO funds well into FY17, then, in fact, we're going to have to take from our base budget, which is already insufficient to fix our reset. So where we will see the impacts is in readiness. And we will see the impacts in not only our forward deployed forces, but our ability to fight in support of a major contingency operation. That's one. The other thing I will tell you is that maintenance, our equipment will just basically stack up at our maintenance depots. It'll be sitting there. For example, today at Albany, we have almost 20,000 pieces of equipment that are waiting to be inducted in the system. So that's a problem for us. And that's gets at the criticality of OCO funding 2 to 3 years past December of next year.
And General Mason?
Yes, ma'am. Very similar to General Faulkner. I may take it to a little higher level strategically. So really, the Army's got three places where we can decide to move money around that we're given. We can readiness, current readiness. We've got modernization and then people. And so the leadership, again, of the Army has decided to go to 490 by 15. If we do not receive OCO funds, we may have to accelerate that even more than planned around. The Chief and the Secretary have already accelerated from 17 to 15. We'd originally planned to go to 490 at 17. We've pulled that left to 15 just because of the discussion we're having today with sequestration. So we'd have to go to the base, and we'd go again into readiness because that's the money that's immediately available. It takes you a while to get savings with people. You've got to treat them right, have them come out of the Army appropriately, not give them pink slips and give them 90 days to get out. That's not a good way to treat people. And then modernization, which is a little deeper and longer dollars, but we would begin to eat away at our modernization, which I would call an insurance policy for the future. It allows us to keep a technical overmatch to any potential enemy. As if we don't receive OCO, we'll begin to eat modernization even more than it is now. We are risking the future, we're risking the now, and we're not taking care of our people. So it's a trifecta of bad situation if we don't receive the OCO dollars. We must go to the base in that kind of a construct.
Thank you very much, and I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Ms. Bordaglio. We'll now go to Mrs. Hartzler.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, gentlemen. Madam Bordaglio asked some of the same questions along those lines that I was wanting to talk about, but I'd like to go a little further. When you said the 2 to 3 years of OCO funding would be needed when you come back, could you kind of explain about that? So it's overseas contingency fund, but yet that would be the pool of money you would use basically for the reset, is what I'm hearing, right, to do the maintenance and to...
Yes, ma'am, that's exactly right. It's the maintenance dollars, both OMA dollars in the depots and at mm-hmm. unit level. And it's also procurement dollars that we buy for battle losses. We're losing equipment on the battlefield. For example, to date, between Iraq and Afghanistan, we've lost over 2,500 vehicles combat damaged and almost 3,000 off the books, completely damaged. Helicopters, we repaired about 130 helicopters. We've lost 230 helicopters, gone. They were not repairable. So this OCO dollars goes to that. We will continue to take battle damage over the next year. So part of the dollars of OCO is to replace those battle damages, helicopters and ground vehicles and other equipment such as that, and then to do the reset dollars both in the depots and at home station. We do some work at home station, weapons, radios, things of that nature.
Yes. You know, the thing I would add, ma'am, is this is in addition to the maintenance on the rest of our equipment. And so this is this is above and beyond. So for the Marine Corps, the rest of our equipment set, which is really 95% in general, we're still doing that maintenance. And that's what we're relying on our baseline budget to do. So it is additive. But the fact of the matter is that of the equipment that we have in Afghanistan, over 50% of it we brought directly from Iraq. We didn't bring it back to the United States and run it through our depots. So that's to the chairman's opening comment. Some of that equipment has been in either Iraq or Afghanistan for going on 12 or 13 years. Mm-hmm. So to say it's been road hard is an understatement. Mm-hmm.
Do you have those numbers of how much equipment needs to be replaced that, you know, battle damaged?
Yes, ma'am.
You shared a little bit, General, that you said of the helicopters, 130 need to be repaired, 230 are totally gone. Do you have a breakdown? I know you probably, that you could get me, I think that'd be very interesting, of how many we actually, you know, are totally destroyed and we have to replace.
Absolutely, ma'am. We can get you that down to the individual end item.
Okay.
We can get that.
Thank you. I would appreciate that.
Yes, ma'am. Same here. Let me just clarify a little bit this description I gave to you. Those numbers I gave to you, those were battle losses on the battlefield and pieces of equipment that were completely gone and out of the space. We continue to pull maintenance just from wear and tear on the that come out of Afghanistan as well. So they're literally, we've pulled maintenance on hundreds of helicopters. Those are just the ones that took significant battle damage and the 230 plus that are gone now, that were totally gone. So there's a whole level of maintenance above that that takes care of desert damage, you know, from that kind of thing, normal wear and tear. Our equipment, as General Faulkner described, is used at a much higher level, probably 5 to 6 times higher each day in Afghanistan than we would back at home station.
Well, sure.
And then our aviation fleet, particularly high altitudes, high temperatures, conducting combat missions, they do a different profile, carrying heavy loads. So our equipment is taking a significant, as General Faulkner says, road hard and put up wet is pretty accurate.
Mm-hmm. Well, I've got the 135th over there right now, the Apache helicopters, and I talked to them last week via telephone, and they're doing 24/7 operations out there, and so I know what you mean about that. General, did you want to add something?
Yes, ma'am. Just one last comment. We are very sensitive to not spending one extra dollar of OCO money that we don't have to.
Right.
And so for every piece of equipment that we're bringing back, we've actually done a business case analysis to make sure that it's in our best economical interest. For example, if a water buffalo, a big container that holds 400 gallons of water, if in fact we're going to incur more costs associated with the transport of bringing it back, we're not going to bring it home. We're going to try to give it to another nation. Through foreign military sales or through excess defense articles or something like that. We're just not going to incur the cost because there's no reason to add to the OCO requirement.
I appreciate that, looking at that from a business sense. Just quickly, last question. How much equipment will we be leaving there and transferring to Afghanistan? Is that dependent on the agreement that we come up with them, or how will that be determined?
Yes, ma'am. Let me address that. Right now, we've got about $24 billion worth of Army equipment on the ground in Afghanistan. We plan to bring back $17 billion. And I would add that that's our most modern equipment. It's the latest equipment we've fielded. It's our up-armored fleet. It's our strikers. It's our helicopters with all the latest modernization in it. So it's the equipment we really need back. It is our best and greatest stuff that we've used. It needs to be reset. So of the $7 billion, we're going to divest. A lot of that is not vehicles and weapons. A lot of it is equipment we use to run base operations. It's buildings, it's shower units, it's mobile dining facilities, it's some commercial equipment. So there's a lot of that that we will donate to the Afghanis through a process that we're doing similar to what we did in Iraq. Some equipment, we will do our best to do what's called excess defense articles to countries in the region that we're working very closely with CENTCOM on. So there's an opportunity there for some partnership with local countries. Not an easy thing to do, but we're working our way through it. So there's a variety of different ways through donation, through sales, to divest this $7 billion. We look at it all the time. And that $17 billion, man, one last point, is built on the 494 structure of the Army, the active component. If that changes, we'll relook the numbers again. And as General Faulkner said, I would reiterate that. We're not going to bring back one thing that we don't need. This is the equipment we need, and we watch it very carefully. So we're being judicious with the OCO dollars we're given.
Thank you, John.
Very good. Thank you, Ms. Hartzler. Now go to Mr. Lobsack.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thanks to both of you for your service and for being here today. This is an important topic. There's no question. You probably know I'm the co-chair of the House Depot Arsenal Ammunition Plant and Industrial Facilities Caucus, along with Walter Jones, my good friend from North Carolina. And we've had a lot of meetings, multiple meetings, to discuss some of these specific issues over the course of this particular Congress, as well as our overall concern about the health of the organic base going forward. I'm very proud to represent the Rock Island Arsenal, too. I think you're very aware that we have the Joint Manufacturing Technology Center there, and also we have the Army Sustainment Command and other aspects of logistics located there at the Rock Island Arsenal. I've been a firm believer all along in the importance of the industrial base, especially maintaining the base, and organic industrial base, as much as we can in the event of another contingency. And I know that, you know, we're talking about a lot of reductions in force and other things going forward, but we've obviously got to keep our eye on the ball. We have to be prepared in the event that we do have another contingency, and I know you two agree with that, all of us on this panel do. We just have to make sure that our warfighter has what he or she needs in the event that we have another contingency. But I don't think anybody's asked yet today. I mean, we're now in the middle of a second day of a shutdown. And it may be too early for you folks to give us any kind of an assessment of what the shutdown means for the issues that we're talking about today. But do your best if you can give us some indication of what this shutdown means right now in real time for what you folks are doing.
Yes, sir. First off, I would say, as you recall, when the Joint Chiefs of Staff were up here several weeks ago, they described where we were at that time with 13 going into 14, 15, and it was pretty gloomy. And they talked about the readiness of our force and our ability to meet another contingency in around the world that was at serious risk. So I would say that's where we started 14 at, and of course, coming right into 14, we have a government shutdown. So certainly readiness isn't getting better. In fact, I would say it's eroding, and the longer this goes, the more it will erode. We are focused on the forces that are in combat today, so we're taking risk, just as my brother General Faulkner said, in other places, to make sure that our forces that are in harm's way this very evening have got what they need, and we'll continue to do that, as well as Korea. That's the other place that we focus on. So those two are where we're putting our resources and taking risks generally everywhere else. If you would bear with me for one moment, I think I would just tell you a story about it occurred yesterday. So at 1,100 hours yesterday, I brought my civilian workforce in and I looked them in the eye, all 236 of them. And I told them I didn't have good news. I had to send them all home without pay. And worse than that, I didn't know when I'd be able to bring them back. And I can imagine the scene as they went home and told their husband and wife and their children that they were basically furloughed, laid off, and didn't know when they would go back to work again. And would they be able to make rent and mortgage and buy groceries and pay for the college fund? And hear their children saying, but Dad didn't, or Mom didn't, just last month the same thing happened to you? I didn't think it was going to happen now. You told me we were going to be okay. So this compounding of the furlough from last year and now this issue. So when I send soldiers into combat, that's a difficult thing to do. But at least I know when I send a soldier into combat, I'm giving them the fuel and the ammunition and the weapons they need. I feel like I've abandoned my workforce, and that's not a good place to be. And so in my career, I've really never faced something like this. So this is very difficult. And even though it's only day two, that's where I'm coming emotionally. One other data point for you on an impact. We had to close all of our commissaries in the continental United States. Soldiers and their families get about a 30% savings from the commissaries. They will not get that savings now until the commissaries back open. So that's a 30% out of their pay this month when they go buy food and necessities for their family.
Something people don't even think about.
No, that's right,
sir. I appreciate that, gentlemen.
We were able to keep the commissaries overseas going because they just don't have a lot of options, and so we had to take risks back here in the continental United States. They have other options, but that's for our soldiers and their families, it's very difficult.
General Faulkner, I'll be talking to my Marine children soon enough about this, but I'd like to hear what you have to say about this.
Yes, sir. Words like disruptive and unfortunate don't even begin to address the impact of this shutdown on our Marine civilians. And I think more descriptive words such as disrespectful are more appropriate. And so the same thing that General Mason talked about. These are loyal patriots. The only difference is they don't wear the cloth. But many of them have been in serving the Marine Corps longer than I have. And so to treat them like this, send them home, sends a poor signal in terms of how much we value what they've given to our country. And so that's really disconcerting. I did the same thing that General Mason did. And I'll tell you that I had some senior executive service members that have enough time to retire, and they may just do that. And so my concern is, especially as this thing becomes even more protracted, we're going to lose that expertise. And for the Marine Corps, we're pretty frugal service. We don't have the depth to plug a senior Marine and a general officer to fill that. So we will fill that. We won't see it immediately in readiness, but we'll see it over the course of time.
All the more reason why we had them all better figure out what we're going to do about this shutdown here on Capitol Hill. Thank you very much. Thanks to both of you, and thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Mr. Lobsack. We'll now go to Mr. Enyart. Okay. And questions, Ms. Bordaio?
I'm yielding my time to you, ma'am. I'm yielding my time back to you, if you'd like.
Gentlemen, can you give me an idea, Mr. Lobsack, a question regarding the impact of the current furloughs on the morale in your force and your civilian workforce, but can you give me an idea of the number of civilian employees as compared to military employees in your respective logistics branches?
Well, I'll start just with the headquarters, the G4 of the Army. Three-quarters of my workforce is civilian. Great teammates, as General Faulkner mentioned, many of them with 40 years of service. So that's generally, and most of our headquarters, Army Materiel Command, Forces Command, that I've served at, TRADOC, they are significantly civilian employees there. They are our teammates. Now, when you get out into the operational Army, obviously, those are soldiers. But these institutional Army, what we call the generating Army, that really is the base that allows these operational forces to train, deploy, be supported in combat, that pushes them forward, that is significantly civilian workforce. And so they're a key part of the team. We couldn't survive without them. I certainly couldn't as the G4 of the Army. My deputy is Kathy Miller, a magnificent civilian teammate, and I had to send her home as an SCS. I had to send all my SCSs home. I've got five of those. So within the Department of the Army and the other services, I'm sure, is very similar. We depend on our civilian teammates. They're many times the continuity. They've got this depth of knowledge. And so that skill set they've got is critical. And right now, what we're doing is the uniformed forces are coming to work every day, which is about a quarter of my total workforce. And we're focusing on supporting the troops downrange, and about everything else we just can't do right now.
General Faulkner.
Sir, I would tell you that our furlough number in the Marine Corps is probably somewhere around 10,000. We were fortunate in that several of them are accepted. That means there's exemptions for life, security, and other key factors things that they provide at our bases and stations. But it's a moving target. It's very unfortunate, And as I talked about earlier, I just think that the impacts are really, we're going to have a lot of people that are going to walk, because there's other opportunities out there if they're disrespected like this.
General Mason, about half of the manpower of the Army is contained in the Army Reserve and in the Army National Guard. And the bulk of the full-time force, the people who make sure the Guard and the Reserves get paid, get trained, do all the administrative work, the bulk of those people are dual service technicians. That is, they are civil service employees during the week and wear a uniform on the weekend for drill. Are these furloughs adversely impacting those folks on the logistics end as well as the combat power end?
Yes, they are. Sir, as you described, the Reserve and National Guard makes up about 51% of the force, and the AAC is about 49% of the force, that mix. And I would tell you, in the logistics community, which I grew up in, about 85% of our capability resides in the Reserve and National Guard. So you can see how critical they are to an ability to conduct any combat operation and early on. So, yes, in fact, both the Chief of the Army of the National Guard and the Chief of the Army Reserve are both describing this morning the impacts. They were having to cancel training, send soldiers home, just tell them to stand by. And so what was going on at the arsenal, at the Reserve Training Centers and the National Guard armories all had to be put on hold because they're not getting paid. So, yes, it's impacting them immediately.
General Faulkner, is there a similar proportion in the Marine Corps Reserve? I'm not as familiar with that as I am the Army Reserve and the National Guard.
No, sir, a little different. Certainly they're part of our total force, so it's impactful, but I wouldn't. Little different than the Army in that regard.
I yield back.
Thank you, Mr. Enyart. We'll now go to the gentleman from Connecticut, Mr. Courtney.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And again, actually, just briefly, and I want to yield to Mr. Lobsack, the military technician issue, which I think all of us who have guard, units and installations in our districts, is just, a huge outrage in terms of, who's being sent home. I mean, it's all outrageous, but in that particular area, it's just completely almost incoherent, that's the impact, although that's by law the impact. And we're going to be voting soon on another one of these piecemeal measures, which we have actually analyzed with a microscope to see whether or not it really solves that problem. And unfortunately, it does not. It only is aimed at funding drilling activities, by the Guard, and it really shows why we just need a comprehensive CR clean, get the government open again, because you're just going to constantly be squeezing a balloon in terms of trying to sort of fix this thing bit by bit. The government's too big to do that in any kind of reasonable scope of time. So in any case, I want to now yield the balance of my time to my friend from Iowa, Mr. Lobsack.
Thank you, Congressman Courtney. Very quickly, General Mason, as you know, the Army Organic Industrial Base Strategic Plan was released last December, high-level plan to support our depots and our arsenals, kind of fits in with some of the other things that we've already been talking about, certainly in terms of the workforce. Can you provide kind of an update, if you will, on the implementation of that strategy, provide some detail about what efforts are being undertaken to ensure that our arsenals and depots have the workload necessary to provide an effective and timely response to warfighter needs? I know it fits in somewhat with the furlough issue, but this is all one big ball of wax in some ways. But can you comment on that plan and its implementation?
Yes, sir. If there's any good news here, is that we do have a strategic umbrella plan that can help us deal with some of this uncertainty and unpredictability. It's not going to solve it, but at least we've got a roadmap. And that's helping our arsenal commanders and our depot commanders work their way through it. As you know, it has four pillars to it. And It's really about modernization, its capacity, it's the workforce, and also the capital investment piece, that fourth piece. So that allows us to plan. I chair the Depo Corporate Board. The General McQuiston, the Deputy at AMC, and I co-host that with a host of other people. And we work through the metrics of each one of our arsenals and depots, to the health of it, what the workforce looks like, what our investments, all those things that are in the organic industrial base strategic plan. We also allows us to focus on comparative advantages at different locations to make sure we're not having redundant capabilities. And so that's important as well. And you know the work we're doing at Rock Island, partnering. We got public-private partnerships, and just recently we did some work with the Defense Logistics Agency with some of their back orders. Right. And so there's a great opportunity there. So partnering with the other services, with Defense Logistics Agency, with firms and corporations in the Quad City areas. So those are all abilities to spread our work out and reduce down our rates so we can be competitive in the marketplace. And one of my biggest concerns is that if we're not, our rates will continue to go up, and we will become not the choice for our customers. They'll want to go somewhere else. And so that's what that strategic plan is really focused on, keeping our rates competitively so we can be in the marketplace and provide a great product, and Rock Island does that. But the workforce, as I started off with in the beginning of this testimony, is where I think our biggest risk is, and we're really watching that. And I know General Vi spends about every waking hour focused on the morale, that team, and skill sets.
Because ultimately, when we have to rely on those folks in the event of another contingency, we've got to make it as cost-effective as possible to get that organic base back up and working and providing the troops, you know, with what they need. Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Courtney, for yielding to me, and I'll yield back, although I see he's leaving, so I'll have to yield to the chair probably. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Lobsack. We appreciate it. There are no more questions from the committee. Lieutenant General Mason, Lieutenant General Faulkner, thank you so much for joining us today. Thanks for your commitment to find a path through this very challenging time. We have a commitment back to you that we will do the same working here to make sure that we provide for what we know is the critical aspects of what this nation's needs are as it relates to readiness. And as you pointed out, it's our people. And we want to make sure we're keeping that first and foremost in our minds. So with all the deliberations we have both today and the months to come, whether it's concerning funding the government or concerning the sequestration, we keep in mind your thoughts and comments today as how it affects our Marines and how it affects our Army, as well as the other service branches. And we thank you for your service to our nation, and we will make sure that we keep in the forefront of our minds the great folks that work for you and do a great job for our nation. And with that, our subcommittee is hereby adjourned.